Well, thank God. We're just very, very thankful for what Jesus did for us in his death, burial, and resurrection. And we like to use the holidays as an opportunity to kind of review some things that are fundamental about our Christian faith. And I think, you know, in my walk with the Lord, I grew up in church. I've been in church since I can remember. But I was the kid. I was back when we had pews. Anybody remember pews?
Yes.
Yeah, thank God we got delivered of that, right? But anyway, we had this pew, and I would crawl under there and color with a marker and stuff, you know. And if I was really good, they'd give you like a candy or something to keep you quiet. But anyway, I remember all that, and I think as much as I was in church as a young man, I went through a huge portion of my young Christian life without really understanding the fundamentals of my faith and why I believed the things that I did and what Christianity was really all about. And it caused some harm in my life because I didn't totally understand some things. And my heart for you as a pastor here is that I want you to understand things. I want you to understand the kingdom, and I want you to experience the kingdom. And it really takes both. It's not enough just to understand the Bible. You've got to apply it, and you've got to see it working in your life. How many of you will testify to that? And that's why we do things like, you know, I teach you, but then we also do worship where you can experience God, and we pray for people, and, you know, sometimes different things happen and stuff. And it's just because my heart is for you that I want you to experience all that God has for you. If there's something good in the kingdom, I want to have it personally, and I want to give it away. So we're talking about what Jesus did in his death, burial, and resurrection. And the Bible says in Ephesians 2:1, and basically it makes this point that when Jesus was raised from the dead, if you're a believer, you were raised with him. It says, "You hath he quickened." Quickened doesn't mean he made you run faster. It means that he made you alive, who were dead in your trespasses and sins. And that's a phenomenal statement. And we talked about a little bit last week that to accept what Jesus did on the cross and be born again, quote unquote, it's not some sort of philosophic conversion, meaning it's not to where I've believed this over here and now I'm going to decide to believe Christianity. It's not I've been a Buddhist and now I'm going to believe this stuff that Christianity says. Now it is you do change your beliefs, but it's much more than that. You actually are changed on the inside. Your nature is born again. The Bible says that you're born again, 1 Peter 1:23, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, of the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. Which means that in here, somewhere, when you accept Jesus in your spirit, something about you changes. You become, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, a brand new creation. And basically all religion is about trying to change yourself. It's about trying to improve yourself through doing whatever, doing various rituals or trying to stay away from sin or something like that. And the good news of Christianity is that Jesus already fixed you. Jesus already changed you. And that is really good news because I've tried to change myself and it's not very effective. What I want to do this morning is, I haven't really done this very much here, but I love to teach just verse line upon line a little bit to you in the book of Romans. And normally I don't do this just because of time constraints, but I thought we would. Here's the deal. You need to understand the book of Romans if you want to succeed as a Christian, and particularly Romans 1 through 8. And even more narrow are Romans 3 through 8. If you can grasp Romans 3 through 8, you can be really successful in your Christian life. If somebody just accepted Jesus and they said to me, "Max, what do you think I should read?" I would tell you, sit down with your Bible and read Romans 3 through 8 over and over and over again until you get it. I remember sitting for an hour, well, actually, multiple hours one time in this chair, just reading Romans 8, verse 2, which says that the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has made me free from the law of sin and death. And I thought, I don't know what that means. And so I sat there and I prayed for a long time, and I read until I got a revelation, and that revelation changed my life. So I would encourage you to spend some time with these chapters of the Bible. And what I'm going to attempt to do is teach you through some of it together here this morning, so that when you go back on your own time, it makes sense to you. Does that sound all right? And I want you to understand things so that you can then experience things. You really ought to be able to. Romans, actually, lawyers sometimes will study the book of Romans, even if they're not Christians, because it's such a masterfully written piece of argumentation. And as a former English teacher, I appreciate it not just as scripture, but by the fact that Paul was like a total genius. Now, of course, Holy Spirit helped him, right? Holy Spirit helped him write the thing, but it is totally masterful in the way that it is written. And I can think through the string of arguments that he lays out without having to go back. And it's not like I tried to memorize the whole book or something, but it just, as you study it over and over, it starts to make sense. And one of the main problems that we often have in the church is that we'll pull just one verse of scripture out of context and we'll build a whole bunch of theology and doctrines around it. And the reality is, a lot of times it's not even talking about what we think it is. And you might say, well, Pastor, you just throw one verse up on the screen all the time. And you're right, I do. But when I do that, it's because I've spent a lot of time looking at the context around the verse. And so when I'm explaining that one verse to you, I'm in the interest of time, I'm not reading every verse because it would take forever. But I am factoring in the context. So let's get a running start. I want to go to Romans 4, but to understand Romans 4, you've got to understand what came before it. So Romans 1 through 3, Paul is just trying to make this point that everybody needs to get right with God. Everybody. And he says in Romans 1 that the Gentiles need to get right with God, and that they're caught up in idolatry and lust and all kinds of sin. And the point that would be applicable to us today is that there are people that have never been to church, that have never heard about Jesus and stuff, and those people need Jesus. How many of you would agree with that? Those people need to get right with God. All right, and then in Romans chapter 2, he talks about religious people. And religious people are people that have been to church, that have done a bunch of rituals, but instead of their trust being in Jesus, their trust is in the stuff that they've done right and wrong, the fact that they've done a bunch of rituals and that they've, you know, stayed away from this sin. And you know, they're like the guy, Jesus told this parable, right, of two guys, and both of them come to God to get justified. And one guy says, God, please have mercy on me, a sinner. And Jesus says, boom, you're justified. But the other guy says, thank God I'm not like this bum over here in the gutter, this jerk that doesn't ever do anything right. Thank God I tithe and I go to church and I read my Bible every Sunday. And his trust is in his own righteousness and his own holiness and the stuff that he's done. Mm-hmm. And Jesus says that that guy is not justified. Why is he not justified? Because there's only one way, we'll talk about in a moment, to get right with God, and it's through Jesus. It's not through a bunch of stuff that I do. Now, is it good to read your Bible? Sure. Is it good to come to church? Absolutely. But the argument of Romans 1 is that if you're in sin, you need to get right with God. The argument of Romans 2 is that even if you're in some religious stuff, that doesn't mean that you're right with God, because your faith might be in your religion and not in a Savior. And then in Romans 3, he basically comes to this conclusion. Now in your notes, I typed it wrong. Forgive me. Even though I was an English teacher, I was never a very good proofreader, because I just don't like the details. I just don't. So it should say Romans 3:23. And Romans 3:23 says, for that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. How many of you heard that scripture before? That's one of the most famous scriptures in the Bible. I could quote that from a very young age, And we would all quote that, and we'd all look very solemn, and we'd say, yes, all have sinned. Are you a sinner? Yeah, I'm a sinner. Yeah, we're all sinners. We're all terrible people, and so life is hard. And the very next verse, actually, again, we're talking about context. I'm not going to turn there, but it says, being justified freely by his grace. That's the very next verse. It says, all have sinned, but you can be justified. In other words, that condition is changeable. Amen. It's not, doesn't have to be a permanent condition. Okay, let's say this together. Being a sinner is not a permanent problem. There is a solution. All right, and Romans 4 lays out the solution. Romans 1 through 3, the whole, if I could sum it up for you, it's people need to get right with God. And the way it describes that is it uses the word righteousness. So it's people need righteousness. But when it says that, it just means they need to get right with God. Okay, and then Romans 4, we're going to start at verse 1, begins to lay out how to actually do that. Man, if there's a way to get right with God, I want to know about it. And more than that, I want to be able to, I know this is familiar territory to a lot of people, but you ought to be able to explain this to somebody else.
Amen.
Really? Right? And so, all right, so Romans 4, verse 1, Paul starts to argue or explain how to get right with God. And he says, what shall we say then that Abraham, our father, has according to the flesh, has found? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to brag about, but not before God. So Paul latches on to this amazing principle that was actually found in the Old Testament. Look at verse 3. What says the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Okay, Paul's saying this. And he's talking to Jews, and so they know their history. And he's saying, listen, guys, I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but if you look back in the book of Genesis, there was this guy, Abraham, that we all love, and it says that he was right with God. But then he asked, did you notice how he got right with God? Because it's not what a lot of you think. It's not because he was circumcised. It's not because he kept the Mosaic law. It's not because he did a lot of good things and avoided a bunch of bad things. It's because he believed God, and God counted that unto him for righteousness. He says in verse 2, if Abraham was justified by his works, he could glory or brag about it. If I'd ever met somebody that was right with God because they were a holy person in their own right, that person could brag. That'd be impressive. If anybody ever did 100... If, to be right with God, you have to be as holy as Jesus. That's the standard. All right? So I don't know about you. I mean, you might be a great person. You might be better than me. But if you compare yourself to Jesus, you need some help.
Amen.
And that's the whole point of the gospel, is you need some help.
Yes.
Help me, Jesus. That's a great, great prayer, right? And Abraham was not right with God. He wasn't justified by his works, but by something he believed. Now, verse 4 says this, now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. What's that mean? If you go do a job for me and I agree to pay you $100 and you do the job and then I pay you $100, was that grace? No, because you did the job for me and I paid you what I agreed to pay you. But if you just come over to my house and I say, here's $100. Why? Because I love you. That's grace. Grace is free. Verse 5, but to him who does not work, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. What's this saying? It's saying that there's a way to get right with God which does not involve working.
Yes, hallelujah.
There's this thing called the religious treadmill. And what the religious treadmill is when I get on this thing and I believe I've got to do A, B, and C, and everybody's got a different list, and I keep doing A, B, and C, hoping that I'm going to get somewhere with God, hoping that I'm going to get somewhere in the kingdom. But I've run on treadmills for like hours, and I look around and I have not made it anywhere. I mean, I am in the same place, and it can be really frustrating. The religious treadmill is just the same way. It's you're praying hard an hour a day, and you're reading your Bible every day, and you're doing all this stuff, and it seems like, boy, I don't know that I'm any closer to being right with God. And the truth is, you aren't any closer, because you can't pray enough, you can't read enough, you can't do enough to earn your way into right relationship with God. It has to come as a free gift. It has to come by grace. Verse 6 says this: even as David also describes the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes righteousness apart from works, saying, blessed is the man, blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Everybody say this with me: God is not holding my sin against me.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's encouraging. That's what it means. Blessed is the man. The word blessed means happy. I knew this guy that he had this T-shirt made, and on the back of it, it said, on the front it said, "Did you know?" And then on the back it said that God is not holding your sin against you. And it quoted 2 Corinthians 5:19. And he said he went into McDonald's or some restaurant, and he was standing in line, and he saw this guy come up behind him, and he could feel his eyeballs on the back of his shirt. And then all of a sudden the guy starts swearing, just blankety blank, and he says, you know, I won't, expletive, expletive. And he grabs the guy and he turns around and he says, "Is that true?" And the guy is like, "I'm just trying to buy a hamburger." But yeah, it's true. God's not mad at you. God's not holding your sin against you. And he says, F, you know, he says, "Why didn't anybody tell me this? Why didn't anybody tell me? What must I do?" And he said, "Well, just believe on Jesus. Just accept the free gift of His grace. Just quit trying to earn it and just recognize that God loves you and He came down here to die so that you could be in right relationship with Him. Just give up and trust Jesus." Verse 6, just as David, I already read that. I got excited.
That's all right.
Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Why is God not holding your sin against you? It's not because you didn't sin. It's because He imputed your sin to Jesus.
Yes.
He put your sin on Jesus. So Jesus effectively on the cross, all right, here's what it's like. It's like He looked at Roberta, and He said, "Now, Roberta, I want you to understand. I want you to think about all the sins that you've done in your life. All right? Are you thinking about them? All right." And so Jesus says this: Now, daughter, I want you to understand. You didn't do those. I did those. I did those. And I'm going to go up here and die.
Thank you, Jesus.
As you.
Thank you, Daddy.
Man, He's good.
Amen.
That's some amazing stuff right there.
Yes,
well,
yes.
That's how you get right with God. So He says, my notes explain how to get right with God. It's real simple. It's by faith in Jesus.
Faith in Jesus.
So it's just you just believe that Jesus died on the cross, that He rose from the grave.
Yes.
And you just make Him Lord of your life.
Thank you, Dad.
And the Bible says that you're justified.
Hallelujah.
Not because of anything you did, right or wrong. Now, after Romans 4, the dialogue begins to shift, because it's not so much about how to get right with God, it's about the results of being right with God.
Yes.
In other words, now that I'm right with God by faith, instead of being on the religious treadmill, what does that earn for me, or what does that do for me? So let's look at Romans 5, verse 1. It says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. How many of you like to have peace in your relationship with God? Not feel like God's angry at you. Not feel like your relationship with God's going up and down like all this. Well, how do you do that? It's when you recognize that you're justified by faith, not by some religious activity. If I've got to confess every sin, every time I mess up, then my faith is not in Jesus, it's in my ability to confess my sins. If I've got to, and that'll cause me to not have peace, if I've got to go do penance every time I sin, my faith is not in Jesus, my faith is in my ability to do penance. And if you don't know what penance is, it's you're doing some kind of punishment to yourself so that God will accept you. And you say, well, I don't do penance. I'm not doing Hail Mary or anything like that. Well, if you've ever sinned and then you've gone over and put yourself on a shelf and said, God, I'm going to go hide over here for a little bit because I know that you're frustrated with me and I know that you don't really want to hang out with me right now because I just blew it, that's doing penance. Okay, and you're thinking that you gotta help God chill out by staying away from him, and then after a while you can come back. And that's wrong.
Amen.
Your faith's in your ability to get away from God and have him chill out rather than in Jesus. Okay, Jesus, God never needed to chill out. He's always loved you.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, and Jesus didn't pay off God. You know, a lot of people have this idea that God's doesn't really like people very much, but that Jesus died, so now he's sort of obligated to. Okay, and that's some twisted stuff.
Yes.
Jesus is the exact representation of the Father. And so if you see Jesus, you see the Father. And Jesus, if you notice his life, he just hung out with sinners all day long. People that had messed up lives.
Yes.
Anybody in here got a messed up life? Okay. All right. Jesus has no problem hanging out with you.
Thank you, Jesus.
So don't go put yourself on a shelf if you mess up. Just run straight back to Daddy God.
Amen.
You have peace with God because you're justified by faith. Now he says this in verse 2, through whom we also have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. I could teach about that for a long time, but in the interest of time, we'll skip ahead. Then he says this, not only that, but we glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulations produce perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which is given to us. Okay. This is a strange verse of Scripture because it seems to be saying that if you know you're right with God by faith, you can be happy even if you have problems. And in fact, it is saying that. And here's what it's saying. It's this interesting progression. He says, we rejoice in tribulation because tribulation produces, the King James says, patience. Patience is just when you believe God for something over a long period of time, when there's a distance between your prayer and the answer. Anybody ever experienced that? Sure you have. When there's a gap between what I'm believing for and what I'm seeing in my life, then that's an opportunity for me to be patient, which is not just sitting around being depressed. It's hanging on to hope, believing that something good is coming.
Amen.
All right, and then as I have patience, it says that patience produces experience. What's experience? Experience is when you get the breakthrough.
Yes.
And then that experience does what? It produces more hope.
Yes, yes.
Why? Because if God brought the breakthrough in the past,
right.
I've got hope to believe that'll happen in the future.
Amen.
Here's a simple example of how this works. When I was lived here, I lived here from 2008 to 2011, and then God moved us to Colorado Springs, and then we came back, and, you know, anyway. So we were here, and I was a high school English teacher. I taught at Shawnee Mission North High School, and alumnus back there. So anyway, I was there, and we had, how many of you remember the housing collapse in 2008? And that caused a lot of problems for a lot of people. And if the housing prices go down, a lot of school funding comes through property taxes. And the school district I was in, we had major budgetary shortfall because of the housing collapse. And I was a low man on the totem pole, and they had to fire some people. They had to get rid of some people. And I was a low man on the totem pole, so they called me in. They said, hey, we've non-renewed your contract for next year. We're sorry, but, you know, well, there's no money. And so that's kind of stressful. That's how many of you will admit that's a tribulation, okay? It's a trial. It's a difficulty.
Yes, yes.
But God had actually been dealing with me before this, and he'd given me, before I even knew this was happening, he'd been talking to me about Philippians 4:19, about how he provides all of my needs. And I didn't do it perfectly, but I really wasn't super stressed out about it. And I told, and we just bought a house, and Molly and I talked, and I said, we aren't going to lose the house. God's going to provide. It's going to be all right. And but there was this gap between that moment and about a month and a half later, I got a better job. So God helped me, but there's this gap. And during that gap, I got to be patient.
Yes.
I got to hold on to hope, and I got to keep believing that something good's coming. But here's what happened. Then I got the breakthrough, and I got a better job and a better situation, and it made me really happy because after 2 years, I was about to quit teaching anyway because it was brutal. But I got a better situation. Got any teachers out there? Bless you. Awesome job. So I have utmost respect for you. So anyway, I got another job, and I got this experience, and the experience was I had a tribulation, something bad happened to me, but God delivered me. And this experience creates a lot of hope in my heart for future breakthrough. If I have financial difficulty again, I've got history with God that says I'm going to be okay. That's what this passage of Scripture is saying. But that only works when I recognize that it's not about my own goodness or works. Because if I think that God got me that better job because I'm such a holy person in my flesh,
tell it.
Then my faith is not in Jesus, my faith's in me, and I'm going to be disappointed.
Make it plain.
All right, is this okay? I know we're just kind of going awesome. Verse by verse here.
Yeah.
And then he says, verse 6, for when we were without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, but perhaps for a good man some would even dare to die. But God demonstrated his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. All right, those three verses there prove to us that God's love for us is not based on anything we do or don't do, because it's saying when you were at your absolute worst, that's when Jesus died for you.
Yes.
Right? Now, when I was a kid, I knew this like the back of my hand, and I would tell you, God loves sinners. God is not mad at anybody that doesn't know him. God's out there loving people. But man, I was in church, and God was mad at me. Why? Because God has mercy for sinners, but I'm his kid and I know better, and so he's frustrated with me. However, this next verse says, all right, now notice verse 8. God demonstrated his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Verse 9 is the actual point. Because remember, he's already told you how to get right with God. So now he's talking about on the other side of that. What's life like now that you're saved, now that you're in Jesus? And he says, Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we'll be saved by his life. What's that mean? If God loved you enough to die for you before you even knew him, before you even accepted him, how much more now that you've accepted Jesus, is he not going to be mad at you? Is he going to have patience with you? Is he going to love you? Is he going to accept you and not reject you? You know, if I've got more grace for somebody else's kids than my own, I've got a problem.
Amen.
Now, I discipline my kids and I make sure they understand things, but if you think, I mean, I remember thinking, I had such a twisted perspective. I remember thinking as a kid, man, I wish I hadn't known about Jesus. Because it wouldn't have been easier to just live like a heathen and then on my deathbed accept Jesus. Because I knew God had grace for people that did that. But for me, you know, he's frustrated with me. And that's totally inaccurate.
Praise God, this is awesome. Thank you, Pastor.
And just to show that a little bit further, let's skip ahead just a little bit. Verse 21, so that as sin reigned in death, even so grace might reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The word reign means to be in charge. Now remember, he's talking about what happens to you after you've accepted Jesus. And he says that what was happening was that sin was in charge of your life. And what sin did is it brought death. But now that you've accepted Jesus, even so grace might rule in your life through righteousness. And what's that going to do? It's going to produce life.
Yes.
And more life. Now, what is the difference here? It's saying sin isn't in charge, grace is in charge.
Hallelujah.
What does that mean? It means this. Okay, if I go to Jesus and I say, Jesus, I have a problem. Anybody ever had a problem? And I go to Jesus and I say, here's my problem. I got fired from my job. If sin was in charge, sin would say, well, you don't really deserve a better job, so you just go be broke. Because I've sinned. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It's if sin was in charge, I don't deserve anything from God. And that only leads to death. But sin is not the boss anymore. Thank you, Jesus. Grace is the boss. What does grace say? Grace says, you get it, you can have that new job, not because of something you did, but because of what Jesus did in your place.
Thank you, Daddy. Thank you.
I'd say, well, I'm sick. I need a miracle. Well, if sin was in charge, you don't have much hope of God helping you. But sin's not in charge. Grace is in charge.
Yes, yes. Preach it.
Man, that is good news.
It is.
I'm happy about that. because I know me.
Yes. Yes.
Some of you think, oh, you're a great person. God would help you. Well, you don't know me like I know me. All right, let's make one final point here, and then we'll pray for everybody. Skip over to Romans chapter 6. So Romans chapter 6 starts to make the case that you're dead to sin, and we talked about that last week. Anybody been on our new website? That's all up there. It looks really nice. We're still working on getting the messages up there, so that last week will be up there, but it looks really nice, and Daniel did a phenomenal job on that, so... Give him a hug for me if you see him. So anyway, but Romans 6 starts to talk about the fact that you're dead to sin. And then I want to actually read this to you in the Amplified. Romans 6, 10 and 11 says this, for the death that Jesus died, he died to sin, ending its power and paying the sinner's debt once and for how long? How many times did Jesus die for your sins? One time. And the life that he lives to glorify God in unbroken fellowship with him. Is Jesus experiencing broken fellowship with the Father?
No.
Ever?
No.
No. Did he experience broken fellowship with the Father? When? One time on the cross, he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, I would actually argue that God did not forsake Jesus on the cross, that what Jesus was experiencing, according to Isaiah 59, is the human blindness that we experience because of sin. And Isaiah 59 talks about that God's arm isn't shortened, that he can't save, and that his ear is not messed up, that he can't hear. When Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? God wasn't the problem that didn't have a problem hearing. God didn't have a problem saving. The problem is that sin makes it hard for us to see and hear God.
Yes, yes.
Anybody ever felt like God forsook them?
Yes.
It's a lie. It's a lie. Colossians 1:23 says that we sometimes get, we feel far away in our minds because of wicked works, but it's in our minds. It's not reality. The reality is the Father's arms are always open. But now notice this. It says, even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin. How many times did you die to sin? One time, just like Jesus, and your relationship to it broken, but alive unto God in unbroken fellowship with Him. Brothers and sisters, because of Jesus, your connection to Father God, your relationship with Father God is no longer contingent on what you do right and wrong. Your sin cannot break your fellowship with your Father because you died unto sin one time on the cross and now you live forever in unbroken fellowship with Him. The reason this is such a big deal, I thought, because I was taught this, that sin still causes God not to be able to listen to me, and that it's breaking my relationship, and I got to get rid of all the sin before God can talk to me. And that is a major problem, because if you're in sin, the only person that can help you get out is Jesus. And if He can't talk to you, you've got a problem. How many of you believe that Jesus was the perfect embodiment of the Father? Did Jesus say that? Who did Jesus talk to on the earth? Sinners. Did they have all their stuff straightened out?
No.
Talking to Jesus helped them straighten their stuff out.
Yes.
The whole point of Jesus coming down here is so that you can connect with Him in a real way, and it's not based on your righteousness or your own performance and stuff like that. And when I saw this, here's what this does. All right, when you mess up, you stop running from God and you start to run to Him. And when you do that, your life will start to change. All right, let's all stand up. Let's have my prayer team come down here. This is what Resurrection Sunday is about. The reason Jesus, it says He was raised from the grave, He was raised out of that place of disconnection from the Father. And you were raised with Him. And now you can be just like the prodigal and you can come home to Daddy. Just come home. And you know, I don't know where all of you are, and I just appreciate everybody so much for being here. Let's have every head bowed and every eye closed. If you don't know this morning that you are right with God, if you aren't sure and you want to be sure, it's not about what you've done or haven't done. It's just this simple thing about whether or not you put your faith in Jesus. And you can do that this morning. The Bible says you just confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead and you shall be saved. So if you haven't done that and you'd like to this morning, I just want to give you an opportunity. Just raise your hand up real quickly. We won't embarrass you. I just want to see if there's anybody to pray for. Give you another moment. If there's anybody that doesn't know you're right with God and you'd like to. Awesome. All right. Praise God. I'm glad everybody's right with Jesus. So if you need prayer for something else, I've got an awesome prayer team down here. They'd love to pray with you. If you need anything, remember, sin's not in charge, so it's not about whether or not you did anything right or wrong. It's about, the answer is about His grace. Grace says yes. Amen. So I'm going to pray for everybody. If you need personal prayer, you come down here and pray with one of my prayer team members. They'd love to agree with you. And then Molly and I will be down here in front. If you're new or you'd like to talk to us, we'd love to meet with you. So, Father, we just love You. We thank You, Jesus, for coming back from the dead. Thank You that You're stronger than sin, that You're stronger than failure, that You're bigger than our mistakes, and that You helped us to be in unbroken communion with the Father. We just bless these people. We thank You for a great week in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Happy Resurrection Day. You guys have a great week.
Good job, Pastor. Good job.
If you need prayer, come down. If you want to meet Molly and I, we'll be down here.